Amen and amen again. In the book of John, in St. John chapter 4, and I did a little piece of it, and somebody said, well, you ought to preach this on Sunday morning. So I said, all right, I'll try it if I can read. And in chapter 4, of course, chapter 1 opens up with John presenting Jesus as the Son of God. In chapter 2, he becomes the Son of Man. In chapter 3, of course, he is the divine teacher as he expostulates the doctrine of salvation to no less person than Nicodemus. In chapter 4 now, he encounters the woman at the well. And in verse 16, it says, Jesus saith unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had 5 husbands. Is that the first time you saw that? And he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. And that saidest thou truly. The woman saith unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worship in the mountain. Ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship what ye know not. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman saith unto him, I know that the Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. I want you to look at somebody with all the strength you can find and ask him, how low can you go? Just how low can you go? The Hebrew thought, of course, becomes the basis of the woman's question. And oftentimes when we are confronted, I have a tendency to avoid dealing with personal issues by asking questions. And it is obvious that she had some personal issues, considering that she was married 5 times. I remember I had a brother in the church in Longview, Texas, and he had the unmitigated gall and audacity to blame all the women he had in his life. And he couldn't find that something had to be radically wrong with him if he was married 4 times. I mean, if you're married 4 times, you can't blame anybody but yourself. Amen. I can't see you anyway. No. She obviously had some personal issues, and to avoid the issues, we generally ask questions. How do you answer a question with a question? But to avoid having to deal with who you are and what you are, we generally skirt things. It's not easy always to have to face who you are. And that's one of the difficulties of life, is that sooner or later you have to deal with who you are. I think I work quite a lot sometimes not to have a quiet time. Because in quiet times, you have to deal with who you are. She couldn't stay married, and In this text, we blame her, but oftentimes we fail to understand that in biblical times, the woman didn't have the kind of power that women have today. So she was simply a pawn in somebody else's hand, and she could be pushed aside whenever the man chose to push her aside. So she really didn't have that much power over whether or not she would stay married. The whole point is that she obviously was seeking satisfaction and couldn't get any because she could not maintain or keep the attention of the people or person who was with her. I think it's interesting because oftentimes we have a tendency and a proclivity to give up when things don't go our way. But I noticed something about her is that she insisted and she was not about to quit, because what she wanted, and she wasn't going to give up no matter how difficult it is. If you notice Jesus, he has a tendency to wait and ambush people who were seeking something in their lives. And he has a proclivity of just hanging around where you're going to end up. And if I were preaching something else, it would simply be the ambush at the well. Because he has a way of coming into the normalcy of all of our lives and introduces himself in a revelatory manner that brings us what it is we couldn't find outside of him. If you're looking for satisfaction, then of course the only way to get it is to find Jesus. And Jesus has a way of showing up in the midst of your ordinariness and give you something extraordinary, because she is a victim who cannot find what it is she is looking for. I have many times sought the Lord in many things, and I found out that he rewards those who seek him earnestly. And there has to be a hunger and thirst after righteousness. And only when you get to the place where you discover you can't do it by yourself is when he enters into the picture. Oh, I'm waking up. I'll be all right in a minute. It's a critical piece that all of us have to drive to get to where we've got to go. And sometimes in driving, we fail to realize if we don't get help from God, we will never achieve even the things we feel we want the most. Because nobody can satisfy the soul and the spirit like God. It seems she's in a situation where nothing lasts, and what lasts doesn't satisfy. A friend of mine said, I think I told you before, he said, and oftentimes we want what we can't have. We have what we can't keep, and we end up keeping what we least want. And life has a way of bringing you to a certain point and then disappointing you. Relationships have a way of making you glad one day and making you sad the next. It seems as if all is vanity and vexation of spirit. Prove a need here. Obviously, she needs a deep experience. And she's disqualified because people, from man's point of view, have a tendency of making you less than who you are. And I can imagine, after having 5 husbands and being with one who is not, that her self-esteem is probably diminished until it is totally out of sight. She reminds me now of the woman with the issue of blood, who has tried everything in her power, but instead of getting better, she got worse. And the only thing that is remarkable is the need to keep on trying. when issues will not stop, the drive for solution then exposes the quality of the heart. If I can't get it, but I keep going after it, it's because there's something inside of me that has an expectation that sooner or later, I'm going to achieve my goal. I have a drive that I'm not about to give up. Is there anybody here who still has some fight left in them? That in spite of how difficult things are and how rough it has been, I have not given up hope that the blessing shall be mine. The battling then with limited resources and all she had is, I want better. I wasn't raised in the right environment. I'm a product of all kinds of abuses. But there is something in me that says, in spite of where I was, I will find an answer sooner or later. I have been down and out, but there is still a drive in me that says, in spite of being dissatisfied for so long, there is satisfaction somewhere. Can I preach like I feel it? Jesus has a way of interrupting your ordinariness and introducing, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. It is to the individual whose faith will not let them ever stop. But the drive is, I will accomplish that God has set up for me in spite of all that I've been through. My father wasn't there for me. The color of my skin made me a misfit. Too light to be black, too dark to be white. And the issues just won't stop. Every time I make a move, something counters my move. Every time I think I have it made, something interferes and interrupts. Every time I get to the place where I feel comfortable, something moves me out of my place. But I'm never settled because I have limited resources, but I have a quality heart. I'm a fighter no matter what the circumstances bring. I'm here to tell you that God, He responds to fighters. He responds to folk who won't quit no matter how negative the circumstances are. He responds to people who don't give up, but they believe that after a while, victory shall be mine. I feel like preaching now. Like the woman with the issue of blood, obviously the woman suffered many things of many physicians. Spent everything she had, and instead of getting better, she got worse. And like this woman here, the more the exposure, the greater the need. Because I can't find it anywhere. And that's where Jesus shows up. The more the drive, the greater the healing. Because the greater the effort, the greater the response. You've got to not just back up and let life control you. The issues won't stop. One woman had physical, the other emotional. But she drove anyway because she realized that there is power out here somewhere. And that's what Jesus said. He stepped in the well and said, I am what you're looking for. You thought it was a man, but really what you're looking for is deeper satisfaction than a man can give you. Oh, I feel something happening here. Is there somebody in this house that hungers and thirsts after righteousness? I will not settle for where I am, but I'll be where God would have me to be. There is no help many times in traditional places. There's no help oftentimes in other people's attitudes. Because with five husbands and the one she's with is not her own, you know she was talked about all over town. I'm so glad.